Once upon a time, Lonzo Ball was thought to be a superstar in the making, a potential all-time great. Obviously, his play on the court contributed to us thinking that, but mostly it was his dad LeVar who was constantly shoving that idea down our throats from the very beginning. With the Lakers drafting Lonzo second overall in the 2017 NBA draft, they missed out on a lot of great players, who we can already tell are living up to the expectations, all of which have already been all-stars, including the player he had a brief rivalry with in college. But unfortunately, we can't say the same thing about Lonzo, partly because the expectations that were put on him were unfairly high. Leading up to the 2017 NBA draft, he was being compared to Jason Kidd due to his passing and playmaking ability, which I don't think was really an absurd comparison at all. It actually made sense. But when his father started to say stuff like this, he was basically painting a target on his son's back himself.
You think he can be as good as Steph Curry in the NBA?
Heck no! He's gonna be better than Steph Curry in the NBA.
Not only was he saying that he was going to be better than Steph, he believed that he already was better than Steph at that point.
I'm gonna tell you right now, he's better than Steph Curry to me. Here. Put Steph Curry on UCLA's team right now and put my boy on Golden State and watch what happens.
Okay, I get why LeVar was excited about his son. I mean, after all, he did lead Chino Hills to a 35-0 record his senior year, winning the state championship. So while he was clearly worth paying attention to, it was kind of hard to really take claims like that seriously when this also came out of his mouth.
In your prime, you said you could beat Michael Jordan one-on-one. Is that just, are you?
No, you know it's real too. He's too small. If he played me, he'd cry.
But even after all those outlandish statements, LeVar ultimately got his wish.
Now that this has come to fruition for you, you've been talking about it for 9 months.
9 months? You're talking about 19, 20 years.
All right, 19, 20 years.
You just ran the microphone on me when I was talking about it.
And of course, had to put even more pressure on Lonzo for the hell of it.
Lonzo Ball is going to take the Lakers to the playoffs his first year. Come see me when he does.
At that point, I wouldn't doubt it if Lonzo was starting to get sick of all this, but couldn't really say anything.
As you step back from this, does Lonzo ever come to you and say, Pop, you got to back off just a little bit because you're just laying it on a little too thick for me?
See, that's what y'all can do. That's when you raise your kids, they can come up and say, hey, Pop, you can't come up and tell me nothing.
What's crazy is, even Magic Johnson wrote a check for Lonzo that we all knew was going to be extremely hard for him to cash.
You look to your right. There's some jerseys hanging on that wall. We expect a ball jersey hanging up there one day, all right? All right, good.
Just leave me one or two records, okay? That's it. You know, all right, don't break all my records.
It's one thing when Giannis put that pressure on himself.
Maybe in 15 years, 20 years, maybe my number is up there next to Kareem, Oscar Robinson.
But to have somebody set that goal for you is pretty cruel, especially considering that this is the Lakers we're talking about here. The bar is already pretty high. It looks like even Magic fell victim to the unfair hype, if he was willing to just recklessly throw stuff like that out there, contributing to the matter himself. And on top of that, somebody had already made a mural of Lonzo in LA before he even played a single minute in the NBA. If that's not pressure, then I don't know what is. All of this combined was really starting to tick players off, with LeVar being mostly at fault. His summer league debut was highly anticipated, drawing in a huge crowd of nearly full capacity, but those fans were left disappointed when he scored just 5 points, missing 13 of his 15 shots, but was able to bounce back by ultimately winning summer league MVP. But remember, there was still an official NBA debut that he had to show up to, a night that Patrick Beverley had circled on his calendar. Beverley made it his mission to ruin Lonzo's NBA debut, and I would say he was successful in doing so, holding Lonzo to only 3 points on 1 of 6 shooting, while trash talking in his ear and being overly aggressive all night long.
I just had to set the tone, man. Yeah, I told him about the game, man, due to, you know, all the riffraff, you know, his dad brings that he's gonna get a lot of people coming at him. You know, he has to be ready for that, and I let him know after the game. But, you know, what a better way to start with missing 94 feet guard than that, you know, is.
Man, how much do you embrace?
I'm not done. Welcome to the little young guys at NBA.
Was a great opening night.
What? How?
Lonzo did good.
How? What game were you watching?
Let's go.
Alrighty.
Keep the stats now.
All right, stay in your lane.
Beverly had no other choice but to take his hatred he had for LeVar out on his son, since obviously LeVar wasn't the one playing. What LeVar did was equivalent to taping a fat piece of meat onto Lonzo and throwing him into a lion's den. But to Lonzo's credit, kept his head up and came out to play the very next night in Phoenix. His second NBA game was a much different story. He finished with a near triple-double, 29 points, 11 rebounds, and 9 assists, but made sure not to put too much stock into it by saying this afterwards: "If I play bad the next game, it's going to be right back to he's a bust," showing that he's clearly aware of how things work. Then, about a month later, a game that everybody had circled on their calendars: Lonzo versus Steph. Of course, Curry didn't really have a problem with Lonzo, but when he was asked about his dad,
"Does some of the stuff he's saying bother you at all?"
"I don't want to talk about that."
And John Wall knew that what LeVar was doing was probably going to come back and bite him. Or I should say, come back and bite his son when he and Curry first meet.
"I feel like he's putting a lot of pressure on his kid, though. He just added fuel to the fire to when he probably plays Steph Curry or play any other point guards after he get drafted."
Curry did in fact get the better of Lonzo from an individual standpoint as well as the win. But LeVar wasn't going to budge. He doubled down after the game.
"Do you still believe that your son..."
"Stop it. You ain't even got to ask me that question. Until I die, I will always think my son is better than Steph Curry."
A couple weeks later, another big game came along, Lonzo versus LeBron. But the following morning, most of the talk surrounded around their secret conversation they had after the game, rather than the actual game itself. And it didn't take long for people to figure out what was said. But LeBron felt that that was none of anybody's business.
"Some things could be held private. Like my conversation with Lonzo, that can be, everything doesn't need to be said. People find out this should be some type of privacy, so."
Lonzo definitely showed some promise throughout his rookie season, but I guess the things he showed wasn't good enough. People were super quick to throw around the word bust.
"Stephen A., a couple weeks ago, you said you were concerned that he might be a bust. How scared are you now?"
"I'm petrified. I'm petrified. What I am seeing with my eyes, I am not impressed."
"Your boy, Lonzo Ball, he's a bust. I want to show you guys where Lonzo is on my Lonzo meter today. Yeah, he's sitting right at, probably going to play in China before this is over."
Now, obviously, we can't just ignore the fact that one of the biggest reasons he's been labeled a bust is due to injuries. And the thing about injuries is, nobody cares. Well, at least when it comes to being an excuse for why you're a bust. I mean, just look at Greg Oden, for example. Everybody knows that it was injuries that ended his career, but that doesn't stop people from calling him one of the biggest busts of all time. Hell, even Greg Oden himself is brainwashed into thinking so.
"I'll be remembered as the biggest bust in NBA history."
Kevin Durant tried to come to his defense by saying, "That's nonsense. In order for you to be a bust, you have to actually play and show people that you progressed as a player. He didn't get a chance to. He got injured, and that was unfortunate. But when he did play, he was a force. He's not a bust. He just didn't play a long time because of injuries, and that's just what it is." Although unfair, the reality is people are still going to call him a bust no matter what the reason is. And I'm afraid Lonzo might be heading down that same path. Now let's talk about why he's so injury prone. Could it be because he started doing intense exercises at such a young age? LeVar got them obsessed with working out, so much so that this is how they chose to spend their Christmas mornings. They would also sprint up 1 mile long hills beginning at the age of 12.
"I started when I was 12, so now I'm 19, so 7 years. That's Monday through Friday, every day, always. Routine stays the same."
Kids are broken by the time they get to college, one doctor says. But perhaps the main cause of his injuries has something to do with his big baller brand shoes.
Lonzo Ball went on teammate Josh Hart's Lighthearted podcast. Lonzo Ball revealed that he had to change his big baller brand shoes after every quarter because they would rip.
Reportedly, Nike, Adidas, and Under Armour were prepared to offer Lonzo a $10 million shoe contract before he was even drafted, but LeVar turned it down, giving Lonzo no other choice but to go with Big Baller Brand, something he would later regret.
"Them ZO2s I was playing in, they was not ready."
"They were?"
"But Demo had a backpack, and he had extra like four pairs of shoes in there, because I had to switch them every quarter, because they would just rip. And it's crazy, right when I switched my shoes, and all of a sudden, magically, I got good again. It was just, I was like, man. And then nobody ever talked about it. So it was like, I never said nothing.
He wasn't kidding when he said that there were times he played well again. There was a point where it started to look like maybe he was proving the doubters wrong. He became one of the best defensive guards in the league. And with the Pelicans, he was much better from behind the arc. Then when he got to Chicago, that's where he began playing the best basketball of his career and was finally starting to get recognized as a quality NBA point guard.
Lonzo, what can't Lonzo do? He can guard.
Okay.
He can shoot.
Agree.
He can play make. His IQ. He can rebound great for his position.
Yeah.
What can't Lonzo
do? Can't stay healthy.
You saying I'm loving.
Unfortunately, this guy is right. The only way to keep proving people wrong is to actually be on the court. As soon as he starts to remind us of what he can truly do, an injury always seems to put it to a stop. And this latest injury doesn't look too good.
Yeah, I really can't run. So can't run or jump. So there's like a range from like 30 to 60 degrees when my knee is bent that I have like no force and I can't like, you know, catch myself. So until I can do those things, you know, I can't play. So even, you know, going upstairs and stuff, you know, it's still painful. So like I said, this is definitely something I've never dealt with. Even the doctors are a little, you know, surprised about it a little bit, but we're all working together to figure this thing out.
Although Lonzo is very confident that he'll definitely play again, the Chicago Bulls believe that he may never play again. Let's just hope that there's some truth to what he says here.
I'm coming back, man. Come on.